Good afternoon. I'm Bob Pickering, and I'm the curator, co-curator of the West Mexican exhibit. Cheryl Smallwood Roberts down here is the co-curator. Raise your hand, Cheryl. That's Cheryl. And we were very pleased and privileged to put together the West Mexico exhibit, which I hope you have all seen and maybe more than once, and be sure to bring all your friends. Today, we are very pleased to have the second in our series of symposia on ancient West Mexico. The first one was 2 weeks ago and essentially focused on new archaeological finds in the West Mexico area. Today, we have three distinguished art historians who are going to talk about different aspects of the study of human figures and imagery in Mesoamerica, and particularly West Mexico. So this should be great fun. What the format is going to be is each of the speakers is going to give their talk. I'll introduce each one, and then if you would hold your questions till the end, then all of us will, well, all of them will sit up on the edge of the stage, and we will have an informal question and answer session. So, excuse me. Thanks to all of you for coming. And our first speaker is Rebecca Stone, who's professor of art history at Emory University, and does great work for the Michael C. Carlos Museum as well at Emory. And I can attest to the great exhibits that she puts together there. So, Dr. Rebecca Stone.
Is this loud enough?
Yeah.
Is this loud enough? Yes,
yeah.
It is. Okay, good. Well, what I want to talk about is some research that I did a long time ago and just happened upon, which I mentioned to Christopher Beekman when he came to Emory, that I had been doing some research as a graduate student and run across a type of figure at the Yale Art Gallery, and then I found several more of this exact same style. And he was fascinated with this because the hand of the artist is something that is very familiar from Western art history. Whoops, like this here. People are always asking, is this a real Vermeer? And arguing about it. And they look at signatures like Picasso's signature. And so regular art history is fascinated with the hand of the artist, but here in the Americas, we haven't had as many of these discoveries. And I think that this might be, correct me if I'm wrong, the first a hand of an artist for West Mexico. And the wonderful thing about West Mexican sculpture, there's so many thousands of pieces that we do have the opportunity to do this kind of research. But I wanted to argue today that you need to be a connoisseur. A connoisseur is an old-fashioned term in art history where you look at every possible Vermeer and you become very, very skilled at knowing their brush strokes and all of that kind of thing. So it's looking very, very closely at the object. But one of the most important things to add to that is contextualization, meaning as much as we can find out from archaeology, as much as we can find out from all of these areas that are seem to be different from art history or from archaeology, but they all work together. And art history is actually very interdisciplinary, especially in the Americas. We try to understand the history as far as we can know it, the sequence of rulers and things like that. Dr. Reents-Budet, you know, knows every Maya ruler and all their gossip from the 8th century. We look at Spanish chronicles, which means the people who came afterwards, and you know, they're not the best people to ask. They're the ones who destroyed these cultures, but sometimes they tell us something wonderful. Of course, the things that are dug up that we know the most about, we use those as our linchpins. And none of the pieces I'm going to tell you about today do we have from digs, unfortunately. They're not archaeological, but we're still trying to get as much information from all the archaeology that exists. Ethnographic analogy, which I call continuity studies, which means the kinds of things that are still taking place. So people are still playing the ball game in West Mexico. There's a wonderful case with the ball game and the beautiful mural of a man hitting the ball with his hip. Sometimes you get a very good insight from the continuities. Of course, linguistics and language. You find out what is the word for, in Maya, for he painted, he engraved, and you have that word. Epigraphy, that would be looking at glyphs. Poetry and literature, you would think we don't have very much of that with the Americas, but we do. For the Aztec, for example, we have a whole lot of poetry. What I particularly love is botany, zoology, and the scientific testing. And you've heard about that and the insights that Dr. Pickering and other people are doing here, which is very exciting. But with, say, looking at animals, if you look at a jaguar and you see what a huge tongue they have, when you look at a pot like this with a jaguar, it may not just be the jaguar's tongue right here, but it's an exaggeration of a natural characteristic and is probably turning into a speech scroll, something that is, this is the animal's vocalization. So you've got to know so many different things to do art history. So the Maya, some of the hand of the artist, the Maya, we do have a few signatures of the artist. This is on a very famous lintel and just barely visible. When you look at it in person, you can see it a little bit better. But the signature of the artist is sort of hidden over here in very, very light, scratching into the surface of this lintel. So these are real people who made it, and we can begin to know their names. So I wanted to add to this idea of finding the hand of the artist, this particular, either an artist or a workshop. There might have been more than one individual who was capable of making this particular style. So we can't say that it's always a single individual. But this is the figure that I was working on at the Yale Art Gallery, and she stands about 29 inches tall. So you have some, in this beautiful show, you have some larger figures than that, but that's pretty hard to do with hand-built ceramics. And remember, they didn't have a nice electric kiln to just plug into the wall. They had to build a fire in a pit and get something as big as this to fire evenly and not to explode, that they didn't get a little tiny air bubble in it, and so on. Well, almost fortuitously, went down to the Brooklyn Art Museum and found that they have a pair, a male and a female, with this same style. And if you look at their faces, you can see the thing that is the most distinctive. They have an eyelid and an as if an eyeball in the that is inset in here, an eyelid, and the eyelid has is shinier than the eyeball, which is matte color. So that's a very distinctive feature, and you don't often have that. And you can see the proportions. They're very wide, very tall, and leaning forward. I'm going to talk about that leaning forward in a little while. The men carry a stick and a bowl in their hand, and the bowl looks like it has some food in it. The women always hold a bowl like this one. Hers is broken off, both of their hands are broken off, but from the others you can tell. So, this hand of the artist, I was looking around, and many of the pieces are in private collections or, you know, terrible reproductions, so I had my somewhat artistic daughter make some drawings, and I think that this female might be paired with this male that is now in the National Museum in Mexico, because of their proportionate heights. Just a grainy old photograph, nothing that I can give you a pretty picture of him. But I'm starting to put together, because they did pairs, they often did matching pairs. So we can, by the style, say that they are part of this style, sub-style, this hand, and then by their measurements and their sex, put them together in pairs. Cheryl found one for us. I was very excited to find another one. This is a male figure from the Museo Sui Maya, which I had never heard of, this little museum there. And this is a female from a private collection. She happens to have two bowls, a bowl on her shoulder and a bowl in her hand. You can see he has the club and the bowl. and they have the same kind of face, the same kind of look, a very intense, and I find one of the most persuasive looking faces, because the mouths are open and they look almost like they're wanting to talk or speak or breathe. And I hope I'm not being too Western about that, but they have an intensity in their face, which I think is unusual. So this was an unusual artist. This guy is a seated figure from a private collection, and I say he needs a seated girlfriend. So, and we need to find a seated female in this subhand, and I hope we will someday. And the Yale figure, one of the other things to do for contextualization is to look at others, even if they're not made by the same person, but they're better preserved, for example, in this resist body painting. Resist is like batik or tie-dye, where you paint on something gooey, and then you paint something else, and where you have the gooey stuff, your color doesn't stick. And then when it's fired, then the gooey stuff burns off, and you have these characteristic patterns that are the color of the background plus the black that was added. And there's some beautiful pieces in the exhibition there that have this resist patterning. This is another figure at the Brooklyn Museum whose resist patterning is very clear, and it helped me to reconstruct these spirals and dots on her body painting, and also around the edge of her face, so that she was decorating her face in a beautiful manner too. So then in contextualization, you try to go outward and try to figure out, well, where could this hand come from? And I call it Meshpan or Meshpa, because Carl Lumholtz, in a book called Unknown Mexico from 1902, said that the cura, which is the local Catholic priest, told me of some tall mounds near Meshpan, and that's a Nahuatl. Nahuatl is the Aztecs, meaning the place of the moon. And about the figures from that exact area, he said, the realistic attempt of their maker suggests that he was a great master. We don't know if it was a he or a she, so we were going to leave that out. But I thought that maybe Lumholtz, as a European, when he thought something was realistic, it might be more of these eyeballs that are inset and the mouths that are intense and so on. And that began to lead me towards this area, and the Brooklyn pieces are, so that's this general area of Meshpa or Meshpan in southern Nayarit. Nayarit is the furthest north and the smallest of the states, and it's right in the area right here. So this is from the catalog of the different authors and their articles. The Brooklyn Museum records, we sometimes still look at dusty old pieces of paper, astonishingly, and hand-typed. This was in the records that of how these pieces came. A group of pieces came to the Brooklyn that included those two figures that are the pair that are in the substyle. And it said, excavated by a farmer 10 years ago. He bought them from the original excavator. And it was when Peter First was in the area, and Peter First was in this area in 1966 doing his dissertation research. Now, the farmer says it was the complete contents of a tomb. Okay, we don't know who this farmer is. We don't know if he was pulling Lumholtz's legs or everybody's legs. Peter First's leg. But we will try to use this information, because if it is a cache of things from the same tomb, then that gives us more information. So, there are various types of pieces in this cache, which is quite interesting. There is the similar, almost like this Meshpan style, close to it, is a woman with a bowl, and I can't remember exactly if she has a little dog in her hand. In the other hand, there are ones with that are also quite similar. She's actually giving birth. There's a baby coming out from between her legs. And it's very similar style. And then there are ones that are different. This one has really spooky eyes and is in the same position with hands out, but looking extremely upset and pushing outward towards us. So if this did come from a tomb, it shows that similar styles, but always not exact styles of things, come from the same tomb. And I think we found that archaeologically. They're not all uniform. And so we have to interpret that. Does that mean people brought gifts for the dead from different places? Or that's one of the main ideas would be that they didn't commission all of these from the same artist, but they were brought as a social gesture. Here's some from my area, here's some from this area. And in this cache, there's a pot that's kind of like one in the exhibition that has, if you can make it out, it has the same kind of spiral patterns and dots as the body art. So this is unites together these things that are just a vessel, simply a container, with the people. The clay people is what I call them, and I'll explain why. So that helps me to suggest that this was from this, or to assume that this was from the same tomb, because it was kind of unified in these patterns. In that same cache were a couple of broken off heads of figurines, and this body of a mother and child, where they broke off the head of the baby and of the mother. This is very common. We were talking before these talks this afternoon when we looked at the exhibition, that the necks are quite often very carefully broken off. If these figures had fallen over, then they get smashed, usually. But when you purposefully knock off their heads, that's a different issue. So we have to decide, is it just damage from being old? But if they fall over, they completely smash their heads. And a lot of the time you have the figure, and then someone in modern times has stuck the head back on and tried to make sure that we didn't see that. So you actually have to look inside often with a CAT scan to see this decapitation of the figures. And we have another talk about who are these figures? What are they representing? But if they have had their heads lopped off in many cases, it begins to suggest to me and to others that they were considered to be, in a sense, alive. And when they get put in the tomb, they are also killed. And I would rather call it sacrifice, because killing, Native Americans rarely are killing on the battlefield or thinking that it's death as an ending. They are sacrificing, in a way, giving the life force of a person when they take them up to the temple and take their heart out or do those kinds of fun things that we love to talk about. So I'm calling it ritual avatar sacrifice, and I don't mean just the movie, but the movie was pretty good about this idea that I think is true in Mesoamerica and throughout the Americas, that you can have a clay version, a clay being, what we would call art, but it's not just an image, it's considered to be its own self. So that if it has to die when the person in the tomb dies or another person who's dead is inserted into the tomb, parallel things are happening to the clay people as to the human people. And our figures, the Yale figure and the two Brooklyn figures, have this ritual neck breakage. And again, if they had fallen over, they wouldn't have noses. They got big noses. You've noticed in the show, these people have beautiful big schnozzes. They would not, they would be broken, and they're not. Is this true? Have you seen a lot of broken off noses? No, it's not the same as, say, the Greek sculptures, you know, where you often will have facial features that have been broken off. No, it's the neck. And this would be rather hard to do. You would have to tap it very carefully, but very forcefully, all the way around to get the heads off of these pieces like this. So, all over Mesoamerica, they do this kind of thing with figurines. This is from a site called Chalcatzingo. There were found many heads broken off the neck, a few torsos, and very few complete figures. Such a regular pattern indicates deliberate decapitation. So this is the type of figurine where there's a lot of just lopping off, lop off their heads, like the Red Queen in with what's it called? Alice in Wonderland, off with their heads. At Teotihuacan, the big city of pyramids that used to be outside Mexico City and now it's part of Mexico City. There's a, isn't it a Walmart on part of Teotihuacan now? Yes, that's a sad sacrifice, a ritual sacrifice of capitalism. But there must be 10 or 20,000 little Teotihuacan heads that some of them might have been mass-produced to put onto other items, but most of them were figurines, as far as I understand it, and that were lopped off. This is a new sculpture that Lopez Luján found, and he found it in all these different places, that it had been really broken up into pieces and very carefully kind of arranged around. So this is just another time later than the West Mexican pieces, but where they're doing the same thing, the Maya. They do it more carefully and more sophisticatedly, but they like to drill holes into their beautiful bowls and pots. We call them kill holes, to kill off in some way to render them useless. It's like a hole in my bucket. You can't carry anything anymore, and it is not a destroyed object, but it's not intact anymore. And in many cases, they find them with these plates or bowls over the head of the deceased with the little hole right here. The idea, presumably, being that, say, the soul of the person can go through it, or the soul of the pot and the soul of the person are united in this endeavor. The mimbres from the Southwest, say, they call it kill holes too. So I'm just showing you that this is the West Mexican ritual decapitation of figures. Also Panama, they are the queen and kings of breaking stuff. All they figure that probably people danced on the pots and crunched them up on top of the funeral, you know, in the grave. And you could tell a pot like ours that someone just went bam, and then the pieces just arrayed, you know, kind of like this. A lot of times dealers will come back and put them all together. And this one was put all back together really badly with like plaster, and they were missing a big piece right here. So someone faked this little fragment in here and stuck it in. It's modern right in there. So I said, let's go in the storeroom, let's take this back apart. It was meant to be killed in this way. It was sacrificed. It was destroyed, but not completely destroyed. You have to be able to see its destruction for it to be sacrificed, I would say. All over South America, Valdivia figurines, giant pots like this from a site called Conchopata, where they have deliberately made it into chunks of pieces. Anyway, onward with the contextualization of this hand of the artist. All of them lean forward like this, almost like you feel like they're going to fall over, and they're quite amazing. Yeah, they have huge feet, right? Huge, enormous feet to hold them up, but they hold themselves up like many of the beautiful figures in the show here. They're balanced, but they're leaning forward like this, and with the arm gesture out, there's a real sense, I know it could be, I could be wrong, but there's a sense of stoppage. There's a sense of don't, you know, you please stop. And the men are carrying weapons where they could imply that if you don't stop, I'm going to whack you. And I do say this with some contextual understanding of it, because many, many archaeologists and looters, and we have to talk to the looters, they say that, well, these shaft tombs that come down, the figures, in this case, the figures are by the entrance, and this is the upper world where the living live, like here, this would be a very long shaft, and then there are little rooms down here with lots of bodies in them. And when you come into the room, there are figures, and interestingly enough, these kind of figures, especially the ones with their arm out, are facing in towards the dead. They're not trying to keep the living out. They are trying, I say, keeping the souls contained, is what I say. You dead people, stay in there. Please, stay back. And they're offering a little bowl of food. Stay back. You can have something to eat. But like in Las Cebollas, Tomb 1, the two largest figurines found flanking the entrance, whoops, typo, where they stood facing the dead. According to our informants, such placement is general throughout the shaft tombs. They're not all exactly the same, but I listed a bunch of the tombs where there will be maybe seated figures facing in, or one with the arm out. Variations on this theme of you and the dead are often considered dangerous. Right after you die, is your soul gone on? Are you going to come up and, you know, mess with us, the living? In many, using ethnographic analogy or anthropology, there's a lot of fear of the recently dead. And of course, we've got our zombies and all of our stuff too. But this brings me, my final point is trying to combine this, what the clay figures are doing, with trying to come up with more of a sense of what the understanding might have been at the time of them. In art history, we always have lots of words, like the image and the representation and things like that, which really mean it's just a picture of something. It's not a thing in itself. It's just, you know, and we love it because with paintings, we know we're not looking at George Washington crossing the Delaware. We're looking at an image of it, a painting, a flat surface. And maybe the artist is trying to fool us into saying, wow, that's exactly what George Washington looked like, doing that. But we think of art as a superficial thing. We do not think of it as really being alive. Okay, we don't think of the chairs in this room as being alive. Native Americans might say the wood came from a tree. It still has some life force. You know, the cloth, if it were cotton instead of polyester, might still have the plant's life force. And it's a living universe in the overall worldview of, you know, Native Americans. I know that's a really big generalization, but why wouldn't the clay be alive? And if they're lopping its heads off when it goes into the tomb a lot of the time, they're treating it as if it were alive. Other types of figurines in the Americas get dressed in real clothing. They have wigs of human hair on them. They are given food and drink like people. So I came up with this list of things that would be a better names for them as holders of life energy, that are like equivalent to humans. And there is a couple of other cultures, the later cultures, where we've got more of the linguistics and the poetry and what the Spanish said. So the Aztec and the Inca, the last people, they had terms that I think help us that we might want to think about rather than an image or a representation. The Aztec, the Mexica is what we should call them, used teot and teixitla. And I'm quoting, I'm quoting Carolyn Tate. Ancient Mexican people share ideas quite distinct from ours concerning unseen energies that occupy parts of the body and animate certain qualities or functions of the body. Meaning, we are all receptacles of energy and life. We would call it life force. We're alive, okay? Teot is life force that may be invisible, it has no material presence at all, and then that same quality of life force is in the priest who dresses up and does rituals as that. The Spanish called them God, but it really isn't God, it's just infused with spirit, and you may be infused with the spirit of rain or infused with the spirit of wind, something like that. But the priest's clothing even had that teyote in it. And the Aztec priests, they would bury their clothing as if it were a person because it had the life force that was coming through them. So that's where the material is holding this energy. The te shipla is their word for something that we would call a sculpture, which is a really good container of that life force when it represents a being. This one is a water spirit. So I think these are words. The Inca had one thing, and I know the Inca are pretty far from here, but the Inca had a wonderful idea called a huauqui, which was a stone or physical brother of someone. And each person in this room would have one. And if you were too tired to go to the grocery store, you'd send your huauqui. You know? Right. So the ruler would have one, and he needed to have a war over here and a war over here. He could only go to one. So he would send his sculpted version of himself to one of them, and himself to the other one. They were brothers. They were two bodies for the same spirit. And I'm not saying this is exactly what's true in West Mexico, but we've got to think about things like this, that this would be a way of thinking. They would be consulted, they would go to war, they would be dressed. Everything about them was the same as the human version of the same soul, we might call it. So I just wanted to argue that if you look really closely, you might be able to find, you know, a workshop or a person back then who had a really specific way of making these clay people, and that these clay people had different roles, like stay in, or let's hope for rebirth, the woman who's giving birth. And we need to look at the pieces with and without provenance. That means the ones that are dug up and we know where they came from, and the ones that are sitting by the thousands in museums. So we combine those two things together. We talk to looters, sadly. We look at dusty old museum records. You look at other patterns outward in the Americas and try to find these terms like huauqui or teyote that are more of an indigenous word rather than our word, like an image. And then I think we'll have a better understanding of the past and the beautiful clay people that were made in West Mexico. Thank you.
Some great images and ideas, I like that. Our next speaker is Dr. Dorie Reents-Budet, Curator of the Arts of the Ancient Americas at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, and is a Maya specialist, among many other things. And so, Dorie, come on up.
All right, good afternoon. Thanks for coming out in this wonderful weather today. And thank you to the museum, to Cheryl, and to Bob for the opportunity to come and share with you some of the recent work that we've been doing at the Maya Ceramics Project at the Smithsonian. I am going to, there's no image, is there?
No.
Yay, okay, sorry. I'm going to read the first part of the paper because there's a lot of references and, you know, nitty-gritties that are important to the argument that I'll be presenting. In the second half, I'm just going to talk you through some new research that my colleague Ron Bishop and I have been doing at the Smithsonian. So the 16th century accounts of tribute and taxation among the Yucatec Maya provide an impressive list of commodities in circulation at the time of Spanish contact, while also affording us from our intellectual viewpoint a glimpse of the dense fabric of socio-political relationships underlying these acts of material obligation. The question that Ron and I are asking, though, is can we discern the similar economic interaction patterns from earlier epochs before the coming of the Spanish? Today, I wish to compare both the 16th century configurations from the Yucatec Maya, as well as from Highland Mexico, with those intimated for patterns of production and distribution of classic period ceramics made by the Maya 1,000 years earlier. Now, thanks to Bob and colleagues' research, we have been putting to work at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston investigations of the few West Mexican pieces in our collection. This is Jesse Arista, one of our premier conservators, looking for the pupae that Bob pioneered this technique. So like Bob and colleagues have been doing in terms of the use of scientific techniques for the study of the West Mexican tomb ceramics, and in, I think more importantly, and Rebecca spoke to this, his mission to unite archaeological and museum collections via new analytical techniques. The Maya Ceramics Project at the Smithsonian combines studies of ceramic style and paste chemical composition to search for pottery workshops locations and the interaction networks from the first millennium AD. Oops. So, placing us in space here, the Maya region, we've been talking about West Mexico over here. Now we're going to go to the eastern side of Mesoamerica. Our data support archaeologist Patricia McEnany's description of ancient Maya statecraft as the construction of networks of supply and alliance, which then created a political economy emphasizing exchange relationships. Discussing similar patterns among the Aztecs of 800 years later in central Mexico, Richard Blanton asserts that such a system frequently emphasizes prestige items because they offer a ready opportunity to, on the one hand, reduce power composition locally, but while also encouraging external connections and access. A prestige goods exchange system concentrates on commodities that are difficult to acquire or produce, come from a long distance, require labor-intensive expertise and special artistic or intellectual abilities, and/or embody qualities of intrinsic value based on ideology. Ron and I suggest that textiles were a top tier, if not the most important commodity in the Maya political exchange system, and that competition for ready access to cotton and finished cloth and textiles was a prime motivation during this network formation and polity interaction, both benign and belligerent, during the first millennium AD. The Maya Ceramics Project, which comprises two people, Ron Bishop, who you see up here in the upper left, making the sample like this of the pottery vessel, and yours truly. We combine art historical and archaeological perspectives with trace elemental chemical characterization derived from neutron activation analysis. The technique, believe it or not, was envisioned by Robert Oppenheimer and Robert Dodson, the leading scientists of the Manhattan Project. Here is Oppenheimer and Dodson here at this conference at Brookhaven Laboratories in about 1951. At the end of World War II, the Department of Energy asked them to devise peacetime uses of nuclear physics, one of which was, they determined, was the chemical characterization of works of art for provenance attribution. Developed then at Brookhaven Laboratory, where these scientists were working, the project focused initially on Maya pottery simply because potsherds became available due to a conversation between Oppenheimer and his physicist colleagues at Yale University Conference in 1953. So there was no design behind this. It was pure serendipity. And thank you, Dr. Oppenheimer, from my perspective. So the way the technique works is that it irradiates in a nuclear reactor a 100 milligram sample of ceramic paste that was drilled from the specimen. And what they're, this is the irradiation, and what we're looking at are the trace elements and the heavy elements here that take on very specific irradiation and then radioactive decay patterns. So, the sample's radioactive decay ratios are counted over a period of 30 days and yield a mean concentration listing of the trace elemental composition of the specimen, which is this lovely listing of numbers here. Because we are dealing with trace elements, the listing comprises, in essence, a chemical fingerprint of the idiosyncratic mixture of clays and tempers that were devised by the ancient potter to create that vessel. It is, in essence, a signature of the ancient artist. And now, after Ron has taken the sample and done all of the nitty-gritty work at the reactor, now enters the art historian, in my role as both art historian and archaeological ceramicist, to closely work with Ron to investigate and really to integrate the two data universes, that is, of art and chemistry. The combined data sets allow us to discern these patterns of production and distribution of pottery, such as these vessels here that came from the tomb of Yitzhak, an 8th century ruler of Calakmul, Mexico. Although, I chose a few of the vessels from the tomb, although all four of these, this guy is this one, are painted in four different styles, and this style, in fact, isn't even associated with ceramic production in Mexico. It's associated with production much further south in Guatemala. It turns out from the neutron activation profiles, the chemical fingerprint of production, all four of these not only were made at Calakmul, but were made in the same royal workshop. So what is particularly unusual and exciting about this discovery is that although it's not only painted in different styles, but it represents both very fancy wares and quotidian everyday eating vessels, all came from the same workshop, and this result runs totally counter to conventional wisdom in archaeological practice. Today I'd like to present some of our recent work on the topic of cloth, which was prompted really by Rebecca Stone's chapter in the exhibition catalog. Rebecca cogently argues for a rich tradition of cloth and clothing in West Mexico, which has been all but lost due to environmental conditions in the tombs. As you see here in the tomb of Yitzhak, this is looking into the tomb and looking at the wrapped and dressed cadaver. All of the fiber artworks have been reduced to nothing but this fine powder. This is the typical case for the level of preservation that we get of textiles among the classic Maya. However, in a few rare instances, we do get we do get some hints of the now lost fiber tradition. In this case, these are carbonized remains of textiles that came from the cenote at Chichen Itza. We also get some textile impressions on the bottom of pots, and in the case on the bottom of this vessel from Yitzhak's tomb, as well as this big, very large eccentric flint that came from a cache inside a royal building at Copan in Honduras. The patterns that you're actually seeing here, these are what we call pseudomorphs. This is a crystalline replacement of the now lost fibers. And the placement on these objects, it tells us that these pieces were either placed on stacks of cloth, or in the case of the eccentric flint there in the center, were actually wrapped in fabric. We also have a rich pictorial record of textiles and the use of cloth during the classic period. To briefly and very insufficiently address the important points discussed in Rebecca's chapter, these images indicate, for example, that Maya textiles were engendered. For example, women wore tunics and wrap skirts, whereas men wore loincloths, you can see as BVDs here in perfect white, and then hip cloths worn over the loincloths. And also, rather than clothing signaling individuality, and what Rebecca's discussing in the catalog, Maya garments here too encompass what she calls specificity. That is, they relate to the event for which they were worn. This is what linguists such as William Hanks call the practice environment. So the cloth, the garments themselves played a very important role, not simply to clothe the body, and certainly not to represent the individuality of that person as we do in our society, but instead what it the garments are telling us about the social role of the person. These garments signal such particulars as social position, official role, and political accomplishment. And even more importantly for we art historians and archaeologists, these garments encode the events, meanings, and intentions. These are the things that are very difficult to otherwise excavate archaeologically. Cloth also played an equally critical ideological role during socio-political and religious rituals. The ancient Maya wrapped monuments during such rites as rites of passage, as you see on this monument. And the sides of the monument are these holes that help to wrap the entire stela. And we actually see this kind of ritual activity on this carved peccary skull from a tomb at Copan, where you have two rulers facing a stela. And you can see here that it is wrapped in cloth, as this is part of an accession rite. So probably as the accession rite progressed towards its completion, the stela, which is a historical record, becomes unwrapped. We have the same tradition of the wrapping of important and politically charged objects by contemporary Maya throughout Guatemala and Mexico. As Rebecca was just talking about, among most Mesoamerican cultures, the world and all of its objects are infused with sacred power. They're infused with life force. And the more important objects, at least certainly among the Maya, needed to be contained. They needed to shield humanity from this incredibly powerful spiritual force, as well as shield the power object itself from contamination from the earthly environment. So in classic Maya imagery, we find these sacred bundles over and over and over again. And these sacred bundles held the objects of power that the king would wear that would infuse him with the sacred power of rulership. Or in this case, the divination mirrors. These mirrors were the portal to the supernatural realm and through which the sacred ancestors could reemerge from the world of the dead to advise and empower the living avatar of the deceased ancestor. Or this image is an image of creation when the gods got together and made our world. You can see it's in the darkness before the sun rose. And these bundles are the bundles that carry the sacred objects that would bring life to the emerging world by the deities. And last, buildings, classic Maya buildings were properly attired for whatever event was taking place in the building at the time. And cloth also moderated these very stark, what we see today as tourists, these very stark stone interiors. But if we look at the painted representations, we can see there's cloth everywhere in the environment. And also the exterior of these buildings, very likely these are panels of cloth, be they painted or however otherwise decorated, but actually clothed, enveloped these buildings. The painted scenes on the pottery also feature primarily these political events, political history, but mythology as well as religious ideology. Many of the political or the more historical scenes feature commodity exchange, with cloth being the most prominent item displayed among these exchange events, especially in the scenes associated with war tribute presentation. Both of these vessels are showing us the victorious ruler receiving prisoners and along with the receiving of the vanquished lord, it's always cloth being shown. And in fact, as I started paying attention to the role of cloth in these scenes of commodity exchange, its prominence in all of these narratives suggests to me that for the classic Maya, cloth emblematized the entire concept of tribute or tax payment, although these stacks also might include such things as spondylo shells, or sheaths of green quetzal feathers, or in some cases even jadeite ear flares and other kinds of personal adornment. But yet it is cloth that over and over and over again, when they are showing these images of commodity exchange, or in this case tribute presentation, cloth is always present. Cloth and textiles were also crucial to the success of elite feasting events because cloth was one of the most coveted gifts that could be bestowed upon the participants. The feast goals include socio-political advancement through wealth acquisition, prestige building, and probably most importantly, alliance formation among the participants in the feast. The gifts not only bound together all of the participants, but also the feasting and production systems throughout Maya civilization into a kind of trickle-down economy, stimulating production and distribution of wealth, and also stimulating the production and continuity of these exchange and social relationships. I'm going to skip over a couple of things here. We can talk about those later, but to move 800 years into the future now and look at the 16th century in throughout Mexico, we have documents from both Yucatan as well as central Mexico that describe cloth as essential to socio-political interaction and a key economic indicator by which personal and state power was gauged. Columbus described Maya trading canoes he encountered off the coast of Tulum there on the left-hand side. These canoes were piled high with cloth. In Yucatan, Bishop Diego de Landa, the first bishop of Yucatan, wrote extensively about cloth throughout Yucatec society, including, and he goes on and on and on, about the kinds of taxes that were levied one group of people against the next. And he really focuses in on the tax tallies required for already produced cloth. In the case of this one relatively small town called Mani, which was the capital city of this polity, this little state, city-state type place, every year they were assessed a taxation by the larger political entity of 13,480 mantles. This certainly, just for one little town, focuses in on the importance of cloth and cloth production to the Yucatecan economic system. Similarly, in Highland Mexico, cloth served as a kind of currency. Its value is underscored by the gross numbers demanded by the Mexica state. For example, here in the Matricula de Tributos, it registers a tax payment of 51,600 mantles every 80 days, coming in to Tenochtitlan, to Mexico City, from all of the subjugated states surrounding Mexico City. And the poor little town of Tepecuacuilco alone owed 36,044 textiles per year. That is a lot of cloth when you think that, when you remember that they're not doing this on, they're not making these on mechanized looms. This is all hand labor. Feasting events were equally important to the Mexican socio-political and economic systems as they were for the classic Maya. Mexica control over prime cotton-producing lands in Veracruz and Tabasco, and the human labor required for processing fiber and weaving cloth were crucial to securing the economic power that were needed to drive and sustain the Aztec state. And of course, clothing, as we saw among the Maya, and certainly is well established in throughout Peru, clothing carried socio-political messages. For example, in the Mexica state, only nobles who were successful in battle were allowed to wear these long capes. And every warrior who had taken at least three captives in war was awarded the wearing of a green warrior's costume. The iconography of the costume didn't matter. The important piece of communicative evidence here was the color of that garment, and this was highly controlled by the Mexica state. Cotton embodies a luxury item because its production involves control over very specific agronomic environments, labor-intensive work, and specialized artistry. Cotton production requires particular soil types and weather patterns. Skilled labor tends the fastidious plant, harvests the fiber, processes the raw material, and weaves the final product. This is a huge undertaking that takes a lot of control to ensure continuity of the finished product. The best cotton-growing lands in Mesoamerica are those along the Veracruz and Tabasco coastal areas, especially here at Guatemala's Pacific coast, the lower Motagua River Valley, and the northwestern coast of Honduras. And there are two other smaller regions here in the southern part of Quintana Roo and Campeche State, and also right up along the northern shore of the Yucatan Peninsula. What drew my attention to cloth production was the interaction of these cotton-growing regions and the patterns of classic Maya pottery distribution that Ron and I have been identifying through paste chemical analysis. We believe that the combined data sheds light on the strategies of classic Maya elite to acquire the wealth and the power needed to advance the political agenda during the classic period. So, all right, I'm going to go back here. So at this point, I'm just going to walk you through some of the data that we have been amassing that has led us to this working hypothesis. In yellow here are marked the prime cotton producing areas that are still today the prime places for cotton to be grown in Mesoamerica. The green circles represent the two intersecting patterns that we have identified in terms of ceramic distribution of feasting pottery. You'll see we've got one area here that is linking these two prime areas, and the other ones that are down here are linking these two areas. So, a word about classic Maya politics. During the first millennium AD, the Maya lowlands were divided into these things we call polities. They're political units, socio-political units, somewhat like city-states. These guys were constantly vying against each other for ascendancy, for access to goods and services, to advance the political and social aspirations of the leaders of each of the polities. This was a constantly shifting landscape. So any moment in time is going to be different from even a decade later. This is why the work we're doing in trying to understand classic period Maya society requires us to look at every tiny possible piece of evidence and use whatever techniques are out there to try to reweave this fabric. So this is Simon Martin's wonderful attempt to show the intersection of political aspirations as an overview of 400 years of politics in the classic Maya. It's like trying to do this and represent European royal history from the 12th century to the 17th century. In essence, what we find from the hieroglyphic records is there were two primary polities that were the prime movers and shakers and were constantly at each other for ascendancy. And these are the polities of Calakmul, located right up here somewhere, and of Tikal, located down here in the central heartlands of the Maya lowlands. This is Tikal and this is Calakmul, and you can see that they really have the big, the largest numbers of connections back and forth throughout the Maya regions. So here are the basic patterns that we were finding in terms of ceramic exchange. Looking at the Pacific coast down here, we find a lot of pottery, very specific kinds of pots that are made here. But yet these were we know through chemical analysis, were made here, but were found at Caminalhuyu, which is Guatemala City. It was the most, the largest and the most powerful polity during at least the first 500 years of the first millennium, from about 100 to 600. Caminalhuyu was a major player. And at the same time, we find pottery in royal tombs and other elite contexts at Calakmul, or at Caminalhuyu, that were actually made on the Pacific coast. So there, we've got a very strong pattern of interaction between these two regions. But what we also find at both locations is a very strong connection to Highland Mexico, specifically to the site of Teotihuacan, which honestly at this time was the dominant political, social, and economic power throughout Mesoamerica, even having relations further south into El Salvador, Nicaragua, and Costa Rica. These guys were big. So Teotihuacan is located just north of, well, as Rebecca said, it's no longer north of Mexico City. It is Mexico City, and yes, there is a Walmart at the site. At the time, the 5th century AD, there were about estimated 120,000 people living in Teotihuacan, covered 21 square kilometers, huge place. But anyway, what we find here along the Pacific coast is a large number of artifacts made at Teotihuacan and actually then traded here. We also find a lot of locally produced pieces, tripod vessels, and ritual incense burners made on the Pacific coast, but in direct imitation of those that were pioneered at Teotihuacan. So very clearly, these artists are in direct contact with these artifacts, as well as the ideology, the people behind creating these objects. Yet, we find in the royal tombs at this time, in the 5th century, same kinds of patterns of Teotihuacan-inspired artworks made locally, made by Maya artists, but in imitation of Teotihuacan pottery. And we actually also find artifacts that were made in Highland Mexico in these royal tombs. So so we've got this very strong interaction network here from Teotihuacan along the Pacific coast up into the highlands. The next track is between Caminalhuyu and one of the major powers down in the lowlands through Tikal. And it's the same pattern of artifacts that were made at Caminalhuyu and that were made at Tikal, but all of these in imitation of things from Teotihuacan, including this wonderful cacao chocolate drinking vessel. And it actually names on it this guy, spear thrower owl, who was probably a ruler of Teotihuacan. But this pottery vessel was made at Tikal and is naming the ruler of Teotihuacan. The next part of that interaction network is with the site of Copan down here. And the founder of the royal dynasty, Kenichyash Kukmo, died in 437, and that of his wife. We don't know her name, it wasn't recorded. But we have sampled all of the pottery from their two tombs. along with, we've been working with other scientists who've done things such as strontium isotope analysis on the teeth, that has told us that Kenichashkukmo was probably Maya, but he didn't always live at Copan. He lives at some point in his life, in his earlier years, up here somewhere in the Petén, but also he may have actually lived in Teotihuacan based on the strontium signatures in his teeth. His wife, however, her bones tell us that she's a local lady. In the tomb, what we're finding is the pottery shows the same network of interaction. There's pottery from both of the ruler and his wife's tombs that were made at Kaminahuyu, brought to Copan, made at Teotihuacan, brought to Copan, and made at Tikal, and brought to Copan. The surprising thing that we found, however, is there is also a strong link between Copan and northern Belize, in particular the site of Altunja, which is a relatively small place, but it is an incredibly rich place in terms of the archaeological record, just filled with tons of jade. And also pottery made at Altunja has been found in elite tombs at Copan, and we also have sherds, fragments of pottery, feasting pottery that was made in the Copan vicinity but actually ended up at Altunja. It turns out that a lot of these jades are from the primary jade source, which is located here on the southern part of the mountains, and something that Copan was very likely the major controller of access to that jade. So that would help us explain how, why this relatively small place up here, Altunja, is in fact rich in jade, but it is connected directly to this other cotton-producing region. So the other of these two networks is further north. And as far as we can tell, centered at the site of Calakmul, which at this time was certainly the dominant site up here. Yet what we're seeing in the pottery, let me just show you the wonderful picture. It's interesting here that most of the ceramic patterns that we have are from things made at Calakmul and going out to these various sites, located especially along the Rio San Pedro Martir and the Usumacinta River, which are the two main conduits that go from the northwestern lowlands of the Maya area through the jungles into the cotton-producing areas in southern Tabasco and then out to the rest of Mesoamerica. Simon Martin's reading of the highly eroded hieroglyphic texts from Calakmul has identified now beyond a doubt that actually the royal dynasty of from the 5th century on that was ruling Calakmul, they actually came from this place called Sibanche. The earliest part of the dynasty is recorded here in hieroglyphic texts. Very interestingly, that is at the heart of the cotton-producing region, and a lot of the pottery made in that area features cloth not only as as the primary tribute presentation commodity, but also the representations of their palaces have an inordinately rich representation of the use of textiles. So, if just to sort of encapsulate this as quickly as possible, what we are really seeing here in the distributional pattern of elite ceramics used for feasting is very much a two-part system, one that's linking these sites along the southern part of Mesoamerica and this other system centered at Calakmul and going northwards. And these coincide directly with these primary regions for cotton production. So I really think that we have enough evidence here to further pursue this idea that the access to cotton producing areas and then access to and control of the labor to actually make the textiles were a prime motivating factor that was driving these political relationships, be they through feasting and other more alliance formation techniques or bellicose events such as warfare, but that the commodity of cotton and of the finished textiles was absolutely crucial to the economic power needed to drive these state events and the desires of these rulers to move forward and become and maintain their position as prime players on the classic period scene. And of course, the elephant in the Mesoamerican room is Teotihuacan. I think we need to be paying a lot more attention to the role that this behemoth of a political and economic force was exerting throughout Mesoamerica and into Central America. So thank you, Robert Oppenheimer and Robert Dotson, for running across Maya ceramics at a conference at Yale in 1953. And so here is the Manhattan Project now affecting our understanding not only of classic Maya civilization, but of the role of cotton and of textiles throughout the ancient Americas. Thank you.
Unless you thought that the Mayan lords were just peaceful stargazers out in the Yucatan, no, not so. Our final presentation is by Beth Wilson Norwood, who is a writer and teacher and has done some excellent work on a particular type of figures from West Mexico. And so Beth, please come up.
As we're waiting, I'll tell you that I'm going to follow the trend and read a little bit more than kind of talk from the hip. So,
while we're waiting, I was just wondering where there was a trade route that was established by for color by a cochineal bug, and it was a specific, really bright red color, and the trade route I think started around the 17th. Earlier.
That's not my area of expertise, I'll have to say, so it will have to be.
Yeah, cochineal is all through different parts of the Americas, including South America, because it's wherever the prickly pear cactus is. Southern Mesoamerica is more of the area for cochineal, and I think that it's as old, it's way, way older than that. 17th century would be when the Spanish, who loved it because they didn't have a good red dye, and they had a monopoly on cochineal, which was their second money-making after gold and silver. We could talk about cochineal, but let's
Okay. So thank you. So like Bob said, this talk is going to focus on one figurine style, Lagunilla-style e-figures. And I think that these figurines represent a tradition of portraiture that eschews physical likeness and focuses on the depiction of social status instead. I argue that these figures represent a highly stylized form of portraiture in which the ancestors are identified through key features, especially adornment and body paint. The markings on the bodies of the figures can be read as a visual language that communicate the social identity of the subject to the living and the supernatural world long after the corporal remains have gone. Like I said, I focus on one sub-style, this style, Lagunilla style E. These come from Nayarit. They've been excavated from the site of Las Cebollas, or at least according to leaders they have, which is right around, too tiny for me to see, but right around here. And they're traditionally dated from 300 BC to about 150 AD. They were first defined by Peter First in 1966, and they were eventually divided into five sub-styles by scholars such as Hasso von Winning and Jackie Gallagher. So style E is the style that I focus on, and these are characterized by the naturalistic treatment of the face, the body art, and the cream burnishing and slip. Okay, so the genre of portraiture has a rich history that ranges from verristic Roman images to highly stylized forms created by modern artists. Despite this long and varied history, there still exists, to use the word of art historian Kaylee Ray Spencer, a bias towards naturalistic portraiture and the impression of authenticity. In her 2007 dissertation, Spencer notes that Western audiences often read naturalistic images as being more authentic or truthful in their portrayal of the subject. This assumption fails to acknowledge that all portraits are constructed under the aesthetic lens of the artist, the time period, and the culture. Artists choose to emphasize particular features, constructing their own reality, rarely faithfully representing the sitter's exact likeness. Even a casual student of art history can recall a number of portraits, especially from the modern era, that represent our physical likeness while also being abstracted. Take, for example, this image by Pablo Picasso. It's a portrait of Gertrude Stein created in 1906. So no one can deny that this image is intended to be a portrait. However, the viewer is well aware of the fact that the sitter's representation is not wholly naturalistic. The artist has flattened and abstracted Stein's features, creating an easily recognizable, albeit stylized, portrait. Spencer defines portraiture as an image that communicates the identity to the sitter, or communicates the identity of the sitter to the intended audience, relying on the representation of set features that already occupy a place in the memory of the beholder. This definition acknowledges the presence of stylization in portraiture and focuses on the representation of set features. In the case of Lagunilla-style e-figures, the artists regularly abstract and exaggerate portions of the physical form. This consistent use of stylization creates a set of figures that are easily recognizable as part of the same substyle. Despite this similarity, each figure is individualized through the nuanced differences of the face and adornment. It is the representation of these distinct features which aid in the identification of the sitter, working with the memory or knowledge of the viewer. In the ancient world, the stylized portrait exists in both the Western and non-Western cultures. Esther Pastore notes that portraits are rare, but they do exist in pre-modern chiefdoms. The Olmec, the Maya, and the Yoruba and Ife, Nigeria, are three particularly interesting examples. These groups share the practice of creating portraits that combine culturally specific artistic conventions with individualized features. The practice of creating portraits can be seen in the colossal heads of the Olmec. Olmec colossal heads are monumental basalt sculptures that are thought to represent individuals, most likely rulers. Each of the 17 known colossal heads are stylistically tied to one another through the depiction of the almond-shaped eyes, the downturned mouth, and the flattened nose. But they are individualized through variation of different elements, such as the exact shape of the jaw. Sometimes they'll have wrinkles. Some Olmec heads show teeth, even. They also wear these close-fitting, semicircular headdresses, which are individualized through the various elements and motifs represented in them. See them right there. Although each headdress is different, some share particular symbols, leading scholars to suggest that they may represent individuals or members of a particular lineage. These motifs serve as identifiers and are sometimes used in other, even more stylized portraits of that individual. So this type of portrait can be used to forge connections between members of a lineage by depicting the replication of similar facial features. The phenomenon of stylized portrait can also be seen in the art of the Yoruba people. Artists living in the city of Ife in western Nigeria prior to the 14th century AD once made bronze and terracotta portraits depicting elite individuals. These images feature striking naturalism, although some features are stylized, such as the almond-shaped eyes and the idealization of the face. This tradition of portraiture continues among the contemporary Yoruba. One such example occurs in the wooden effigies used for second burial ceremonies, in which family and friends of a deceased member of the community pay their respects to a wooden likeness of the dead. Portraits created for this ceremony are quite naturalistic, with special attention being paid to the facial features of the sitter. However, the image is also somewhat simplified. Art historian Babatunde Lau describes a second burial effigy of a priest in which the effigy only vaguely resembles the photograph of the deceased. However, both the photograph and the image, the second burial effigy, records three lines on the cheek of the priest. So the marks on the cheek of the effigy function to communicate the identity of the subject. Although the effigy is not wholly naturalistic, these three marks aid in this. The idea of a stylized portrait is further expounded upon in what the Yoruba call the aroya, or conceptual portrait. An Oroya is less concerned with the physical interpretation of the subject. Instead, the artist's intention is to depict the essence or metaphysical self. The artist who creates these images are not required to know their subject. Instead, they are given information about their subject's identity, such as their gender, any markings worn by the deceased, some of which could identify him or her with a family lineage. The subject's identity is further reinforced with a naming ritual in which the subject and effigy are spiritually connected to one another. Conceptually, the Oroya parallels the second barrel effigy. However, in the case of the Oroya, physical likeness is further de-emphasized. Spencer's definition of portraiture is similar to the idea of a conceptual portrait as seen by the Yoruba. In both those examples, the identity of the sitter is communicated through physical likeness, but rather through the representation of specific features that the viewer associates with the subject. In images such as these, the memory or the knowledge of the viewer plays an important role, and the artist must represent features that would trigger the idea of the sitter in the viewer's mind. She studied mostly images from Palenque. Here we go. So in this example, we're going to look at two images that represent Ishtak Kuk, the mother of Kenichanabakal. These images depict the Maya queen are always quite stylized, having a narrow profile with large rectilinear ears, somewhat rounded and exaggerated features, and a frontal eye. And this is Ishtak Kuk right here on this side, handing this headdress to her son. She is also consistently represented with more realistic set of features. These include the elongated face, the large jaw, high cheekbones, and shallow incisions for eyes. The queen is also always depicted as wearing a false nose and as having scarification or a tattoo on her cheek. You can see the false nose right here and the scarification here. So while other portraits at Palenque display some of these features, as are represented on Ishtak Kuk, only she is depicted with this exact same combination. So excavations in West Mexico are beginning to produce evidence that supports the idea that at least some ceramic figures from West Mexico display the identity of those entombed. Excavations at Huitzilapa and other sites have noted that figures are found in association with remains of the same sex. And in some instances, figures are depicted wearing armbands similar to the armbands worn by the courts. You can see these actually in the exhibit. This premise is further supported by the remains of a male found in the northern chamber who is interned with a ball player and whose damaged hip bone likely indicates that he was a ball player himself. The depiction of adornment on figures similar to what was worn by the deceased, coupled with the discovery of a ball player figure near the remains of a ball player, suggests that the figures depict the identity of those that they were interned with. So although portraiture among the Yoruba and the Olmec is stylized, it exhibits more naturalism than that of Lagunilla-style e-figures. This high level of stylization makes the representations of characteristic features necessary. In order to identify the subject, the viewer would likely have to rely on other identifying marks, such as the body art or other types of adornment. So no two figures are depicted with the exact same combination of body art. Or tattoos. Body painting and other types of adornment depicted on Lagunilla-style figures could have served as a visual language that, when read by the viewer, communicated the individual identity of the subject, and more important, the social identity. Portraiture that relies on the depiction of adornment and body modifications to identify the sitter makes up one of the three categories of African portraiture as defined by Jean M. Georgiadi. He refers to these images as generalized anthropomorphic portraits. These images identify the sitter through the use of personal adornment or insignia instead of the naturalistic representation of their physical form. An example of this can be found among the funerary images made by the 20th century Akan in Ghana. These so-called portraits by designation are quite similar to one another, with the exception of individualized scarification or hairstyles. The uninitiated viewer would not recognize these terracotta figures as a form of portraiture. However, audience members who knew the deceased would, declaring that they were photos of the dead. Perhaps the original audience of Lagunilla-style e-figures understood these effigies in much the same way, where the decoration of the body created a likeness of the sitter and not the physical appearance. The interpretation that Lebanese-style e-figures are a part of this genre of generalized anthropomorphic portraits relies heavily on the meaning behind the marks on the objects and the knowledge of the viewer. The designs in red and black that cover the bodies of Lebanese-style e-figures must represent something permanent, such as a tattoo or body paint that is reapplied on a regular basis. The markings would tend to stand out in the memory of the living as something that is representative of the sitter, such as the three lines marking the face on the yore of a priest. The practice of making important or marking important life events, social status, and identity on the skin can be seen in a number of cultures. Among some indigenous Australian populations and some Pacific Island cultures, tattooing is used as a way to mark different stages of maturation. The practice of using adornment in a way to communicate social identity also occurs in among many American societies. Melissa Logan notes that among West Mexican figures, young children are depicted without any body paint or tattoos, and that youths are depicted with only some. This contrasts dramatically with adult figures who are represented with a large number of decorations, indicating that tattoos or body paint are added as one grows older and experiences various rites of passage. Scholars like Genevieve Fisher and Deanna DiPaolo-Lurin claim that social identity is constructed as one moves through their day-to-day experience. The body is the public record of this journey. The various identities that one has through life can be worn or even marked on the surface of the skin. These markers of identity, whether permanent or temporary, are a form of visual language that can be read as the viewer in order to identify the subject's gender, stage in life, social status, or even kin group. The use of ornamentation to distinguish between people of different genders and stages of life began in Mesoamerica as early as the formative period. According to Rosemary Joyce, less stratified groups used adornment to distinguish between adults and non-adults, while more stratified groups had highly varied meanings of personal adornment. Among many Mesoamerican cultures, the preparation and adoption of body art was an important component of life cycle rituals that marked the transition from one stage to the next. Not only can adornment help one communicate their identity, but it can also be used as a tool for this construction. Thus, body decorations depicted on Lagunilla-style e-figures could have been used to communicate the identities of the status, or the identities and statuses of the wearer. So, while each Lagunilla-style e-figure displays a unique combination of body adornment, I've noticed a couple of patterns. For example, men in the Lagunilla-style, and this is not the same for the rest, are the only ones who wear headbands, while both genders have nose and ears piercings, and then both have a rich array of body art. So the body art does vary greatly between the genders, with female figures displaying more recognizable patterns and male figures having more individualized designs. Figures of each gender feature both red and black body paint, with black body paint being used more on male figures and red more on female. Male figures have the highest concentration of body art on their faces and arms, while the torsos are most often devoid of any decoration. Alternately, female figures have had body paint or have body paint located on their arms, torsos, and to a lesser degree, the face. So while there are a few similarities, on the designs painted by or the designs on the male figures, female figures have some similarities. These are the ones that I've seen the most are this little handprint that's on the chest and on the back of female figures. And then they also have this armband with the stripes going down it. Also, many of the female figures have three lines on their face as well in red. So these things could indicate be some sort of body of paint that is specific to the gender of female. So facial painting is also found on figures of both genders and is often consists of marks on the cheek and black bands covering one or both eyes. Some scholars have claimed that the presence of black paint covering the eyes indicates that this figure depicts the dead or supernatural figure. Other scholars believe that this could be that painting on the face could relate to rituals of ingestion and inhalation, and thus ideas of communication with the other world. So if this is indeed the case, then the people depicted in Lagunilla-style e-figures are singled out for their ability to communicate with the other world, likely an ability that would be important in their new social role as an ancestor. Most likely, the body paint or tattoos depicted on Lagunitas Dali figures serve as a visual language that communicates the biography of the wearer. This could include one's various identities, such as age, gender, kin group, and their role as in supernatural or ritual contexts. The depiction of these designs in combinations with characteristic facial features resulted in a polyvocal image that would be recognizable to the viewer as a representation of a particular person, while also identifying the subject's status at death. So portraiture is largely associated with modern civilizations or large-scale ancient cultures such as the Romans, the Olmec, and the Maya, with less often with kind of smaller cultures such as formative period West Mexico. Does portraiture exist at this level of society? And if so, whose depiction would warrant the use of artistic and material resources needed to create ceramic sculptures? Esther Pastore notes that the Olmec and early Yoruba portraiture depict rulers. Not only do these images depict the elite of these societies, they originate from different types of social organization than that of late formative period West Mexico. The Olmec in 14th century Yoruba belonged to societies thought to be either large chiefdoms or small states. These types of societies tend to lavish a great deal of attention on their ruler, who often plays an important role in the religious life of their people. So the political organization of the Teochtitlan tradition is not thought to parallel that of the Yoruba or the Olmec, although there are some similarities. Instead, scholars believe that political authority was shared in a corporate mode, meaning that power was shared by different groups. This is also referred to as a group-oriented chiefdom. It is thought that the major centers in West Mexico were once ruled by elite lineages or elite members of lineages, and it is possible that portraits could have been made in the likeness of these elites. So why create portraits in the form of handheld figures rather than monumental images? The relative small scale of a figure is important to the understanding of their function. Figurines are more personal objects, whereas monumental forms of portraiture are public. Figurines have the ability to live with their owner, inhabiting the same space on a ritual or even day-to-day basis. Figures examined by a number of scholars have evidence of use wear in the form of breaks and scuffs, along with the discovery of figures in residential contexts, indicate that anthropomorphic figures had a life that preceded their entombment, one that involved their use in ritual. The ancestor is an important component of Mesoamerican cosmology. It is especially important in cultures in which lineages or kin groups serve as a foci for political or social organization. When using the term ancestor, distinctions must be made. For example, there are recent as opposed to remote ancestors. The former are recently deceased and continue to be cared for by the people that they are close to in life. The recently dead are remembered by name, continue to have authority in the household, and are intimately involved in the lives of the living. Over time, perhaps 3 to 5 generations, these recent ancestors evolve into the category of remote ancestors. The name of remote ancestors have often been forgotten, and they are less involved in the lives of their descendants. Uninfluential people kind of shift over to this pretty quickly, but very influential elite members of the community would be remembered by name and sometimes shift to the idea of an ancestor deity. Joyce Marcus proposes that figures, along with other physical objects, provide a venue through which the ancestor could be contacted. Different roles or different tools are used by different cultures to communicate with the dead. Some cultures communicate with their ancestors using the mummified remains, as was the case with the Inca and the Cora people of Nayarit. Other traditions are used more abstract but no less tangible means of communication. Among the Yoruba, the Oroya, and other generalized anthropomorphic portraits serve as a venue for the continued communication with the dead. The colonial Maya used wooden figures for that purpose. Diego de Landa recorded this, observing that wooden figures were kept in the homes alongside figures of other important ancestors. Like the effigies by the Yucatec Maya, figures from Oaxaca were used in ancestor rituals. Archaeologists working in the Valley of Oaxaca have found hundreds of anthropomorphic ceramic figures dating from the formative period. Mostly located in residences and household middens, these figures have been interpreted as representing the recently deceased and are thought to have been used in household ritual. Oaxacan figurines do not reflect the physical image of the ancestors. Instead, the face and bodies are nondescript, with the exception of the hair. And the hair likely encodes different kind of social messages about age and status. According to Marcus, this relates into the way, or the faceless nature of the ancestors, relates to the way that they were understood. Using ideas first proposed by Igor Kopytov, Marcus claims that the faceless nature of Oaxacan features relates to the faceless, or figures relates to the faceless nature of the ancestors. In the afterlife, ancestors keep their social status, but they do not retain their individual personalities. Despite this universal character, during ritual they were thought of as individuals. The identification of the sitter was accomplished through the use of their name, and it is thought that the representation of features such as adornment that identify their social status also helped in this identification. So by calling a figure by the name, by their name, the deceased individual is of the object, or is represented by the object, comes into this object. Like Rebecca said, they're thought of as having this kind of animate energy, and by having this ritual where you name them, then this animate energy is able to come into them. So the vessel, or the figurine, serves as a vessel in which the spirit can be contacted and temporarily reside, marking the intangible spirit of the dead tangible. The practice of communicating with the deceased is an enduring tradition in West Mexico. People living in the region, or in the Sheftum complex, were known to practice various forms of ancestor worship. More contemporary groups, like the Cora, kept and cared for mummies that were thought to act as intermediaries between the living and the natural spirits. Lagunilla-style e-figures may have functioned in a similar capacity as Cora mummies. Instead of preserving the bodies of the deceased, the ancient people of West Mexico may have created their ancestors in clay. While the corpse would remain in the tomb, their ceramic counterpart could travel to the surface, where they could participate in community activities, including those involving the communication with the other world. Scholars have long accepted the importance of the ancestor during the formative and classic periods in West Mexico. It is thought that maintaining contact with the ancestors was essential to the continued success of the community. The Sheftum was a special place in which this contact could be maintained. The Sheftum provided a location where the living could literally be close to their descendants, or to their ancestors, and perhaps through rituals performed in the Sheftums that even involved representations of the clay ancestors. As Rebecca notes, Sheftums are liminal spaces that could have been actually considered the underworld itself. Ancestor rituals could also have taken place above the tomb, possibly in structures constructed for that process. In Ixtlan del Rio house models, these feature ritual feasts that took place inside of a house-like structure, with the underworld home of the dead below. You even have a slumped-over figure, which has been interpreted as the corpse. We've also found remnants of masonry foundations over the entrances of shaft tombs, supporting the idea that this was possibly a real representation of the shaft tomb. So ancestor rituals could have taken place in a number of spaces. However, it's likely that the shaft tomb itself, above or below, was an important component. So while figurines aided in the continued construction with the continued communication with the deceased, shaft tombs also fostered a connection containing architectural elements that could have facilitated this continued communication. The underground space of the tomb at the sites of San Jose del Conde and Los Cebollas were connected to the surface by tubes of about 20 centimeters in diameter, and they were referred to as claraboyas by looters. Architectural features such as these have been found in other mortuary structures in the Americas. Among the Maya, they're referred to as psychoducts and can be seen here in this drawing of the Temple of the Inscriptions at Palenque. So this psychoduct connected the Tomb of Pakal to the superstructure that topped the Temple of the Inscriptions. Structures like this have also been found in shaft tombs in the Andes. Some scholars working in the Andes have said that these structures reflect a belief in which the spirit of the dead remains with the corpse for at least some period of time. It's also possible that these reflects an idea that the corpse, or at least the spirit, moved back and forth between the two. So another thing that could be interesting about the ceramic or the body paint is that it could reflect a kin group. So our Lagunilla-style figures could be a portrait of the dead that represents the living. The body paint would likely communicate the status of the dead, including their membership in a kin group. And they could serve also as a venue for this continued communication. So, thank you.
You've heard some interesting things today about different aspects of looking at the symbolism and the perhaps the function of these figures. And we'd like to sort of throw the floor open for questions if you have any questions and can direct them to any of the particular speakers. Do you have any questions? If you'll raise your hand, I'll give you the microphone.
I was particularly interested in the heads being lopped off. So for collection purposes, for maybe even some pieces that we have here in the Gilcrease, have they been reconstructed for the purpose of us being able to see them today in recognizable style, as opposed to us being able to put together these pieces as what was symbolic of art at one time? Is my question clear?
Yes. I think that people have covered over the evidence. The modern people, in order to sell figures, have obscured for us the ancient practice, like the Panamanian piece being horribly put back together so it would be whole. And because it goes against our feelings, we feel like you shouldn't just go destroying, you know, you shouldn't just cut out Picasso's signature and do things like that, that art is sacrosanct. But when they have been purposefully decapitated, it would be better to at least leave the little crack. So in modern conservation, people tend to do that more. They tend to, instead of plaster everything over, and they will at least show, you know, that you can see what they did with the piece itself. Some pieces are just broken, you know, someone in the storeroom dropped it, you know, and felt bad for the rest of their life. But some of this is very indicative to us of things that they did. You know, driving that hole, drilling a hole into a Maya piece, that was done well after they were made. It wasn't made with that hole. It was drilled in, and sometimes it cracked the piece and made it so that we don't put them on display. I've got some pieces in my collection that have such sort of bad kill holes that they're no longer structurally sound. But I don't want to cover that up, because that's part of the life of the object.
So when Thomas Gilcrease was trying to collect some of these for posterity for his museum, were they reconstructing in that fashion or putting them all back together so they'd be aesthetically pleasing?
Well, the curators here would know that more specifically.
They were purchased as one piece. After all, the dealers know you're going to pay more for a complete piece rather than a broken piece. So there is an economic aspect of this that relates to the looting that goes on. But I will say, and I'll get in my little forensic piece here, not all breaks are the same. And one of the things that would be a good sort of experimental archaeology project is to look at how things are broken. When you bury something and you have ground pressure, it breaks in one way. If you drop it on the floor, it breaks in another way. If you intentionally snap off a fragment, it breaks in another way. Those are all diagnostic of the behavior used to make those breaks, or non-behavior. It may just simply be natural, and that's kind of one of the things we need to know. But when you look at these figures, and when you look in the science part of the exhibit, you'll see the x-rays that show the broken pieces that have all been repaired. Well, when Thomas Gilcrease bought those, he probably assumed, based on who he bought them from, that those were complete figures, that they were pristine. And it's only in more modern times that when we x-ray them or CAT scan them or do what we do, we see, wait a minute, that's not the real picture. These things were broken up sometimes much more than was thought. So yet again, there are always these sort of little problems we run into when we get to these interpretations.
Let me just say something about the heel of the Yale figure is broken off,
and some of the archaeologists have found the legs and the feet are still in the ground, and the looter has snapped the piece off. So that's an example of the different types. We don't think that it wasn't an ancient practice, I don't think, to break their feet off, but it becomes as part of the looting. You break off a heel, or you'll break the whole feet off and take the figure and then put new ones on. So you often watch, as a curator, I watch for, and you do at the MFA Boston, the appendages, and people will often add fingers and toes back. And mostly modern ones will always be five fingers and five toes, but almost all ancient ones have fewer digits than five. It's part of what Beth was talking about, that it's an essence. It's not an actual, the big toe has to be bigger and the next one is longer, and all that stuff didn't matter to them. It was, can it stand on its foot like a person? That's me calling them clay people. And we are more literal than they about things like the number of digits.
Another question?
My mind starts wandering, you know, when you are talking like this.
Oh dear. We're being boring.
I understand the problem.
So one of the things that I was thinking is that in some of the cultures today, and some of the Native American cultures in the Southwest, that break pottery, grind it up, make it into a paste, and then put it into the new pottery that's being done, then infuse the ancestors that way. Is there some way to tell whether that kind of thing was done this early?
For the Maya?
Yes.
Even physically looking at a potsherd, any good ceramicist can tell you whether or not you have ceramic temper grog in it, or whether it's a crystalline calcite or sand or whatever. We have no evidence no consistent evidence anywhere in Mesoamerica, to my knowledge, of ground up ceramic temper. Occasionally, we see pieces out of Veracruz, for example, at one particular time period, late in the post-classic, sometime after 1100, there was one area where we have that, but it is simply not the kind of tempering traditions that we have anywhere in Mesoamerica. It is very unusual that it's quite common in the Southwest, but yet at places like Paquimé, like Casas Grandes, they were not using this technique, whereas we know these people were in close contact with each other.
So Casas Grandes in between the Southwest
exactly.
And Mesoamerica proper,
right.
The central part. So,
right.
And they were trading parrots
exactly.
And trading all
the
kinds
cattle.
Of chocolate and all kinds of stuff.
Yep.
But if they didn't trade that
this
different
technology.
Type of temper, it
right.
Was, it's a localized issue.
And so for me as a potter, the question to something like that, which is a very important point for our art historians and archaeologists to pay attention to, and we often don't. So the question for me is that choice, is that a technological choice that has to do with the nature of the clays and tempers available in these respective places, or is that a more culturally prescribed choice that was done because of some kind of ideology?
Because you're saying the Southwest belief is that you have the essence of the former pot
exactly.
And the new pot, and
right.
So it's a lot of what we've been talking about today, about this, that it almost transfers the life force from one to the other,
right.
Which you'd think they would be doing in Mesoamerica, but...
It would fit, but we don't find that pattern. So these are the kinds of questions that we ask ourselves that often are very difficult to answer from using only archaeological data. This is where we have to bring in the art historians, or you bring in your philosophers, or you bring in your ethnographers, or you bring in your linguists. And then all of the technical studies needed to start addressing these questions, because I think these are the ones that help us better really understand what's going on in the minds and the hearts of the people who are creating these societies. So I don't have an answer. That's a good question.
My question concerns the artistic aspects of these. The trade routes are there, but we can see that artistically these things have been traded from one place to another. Are there archaeological evidences of the actual workshops themselves? For example, in Greece they may have excavated Phidias's workshop. Anything similar in Mesoamerican world?
Sort of. In terms of actually identifying workshops, we've found a couple of workshops at Atzompa in Oaxaca, for example. We've actually got kilns. There's a kiln area, which is really just sort of a tamped stucco surface for firing at Cacho, the northern Belize.
Does it have the smoke and...
All of that's gone.
Shows the burning?
No, it's all gone because this is highly acidic soil. What we have is higher degrees of nitrogen from the burning.
I think
it's really hard to find.
Well, I was just going to say, I think you find much more evidence of this in terms of stone tools, finding workshops. But why do you do that? Stone tools, once you make the flakes, they don't deteriorate. They're there. When you're talking about ceramic workshops and kilns and things.
Or cloth.
Yeah. Cloth. Who knows?
A few sticks is a loom.
Yeah.
And a lot of times archaeologists and people, even if they are preserved, they
get the spindle forks and that's
not it. Not good ones. Not recently, but people would just toss them out. So they'd lose the whole sense of the technology.
For a while, what we had thought in terms of archaeological remains, around all of these Maya palaces, there are these garbage dumps, we call them middens, outside the palaces, and they're all filled with broken pieces of ceramic. And so we all assume, well, of course, this is where they were making the pots. But I can tell you, first of all, any potter who's doing open pit firing, you are not going to be burning your pots, firing your pots, anywhere near a thatch roof, right?
Yeah.
Or anywhere around all of your finery, all of your fine clothing, etc., in your palace, right? Covered in smoke and soot, and also you have to bring in all the fuel. And what are you going to do with all the ash? You're just a terrible mess. This is not where they were actually firing those pots. It turns out that those middens are the result of these feasting events. In the case of places like Altunha. The archaeological evidence strongly indicates that what these guys were doing were having their big feast. They were all getting drunk, probably, but still feasting, and then intentionally breaking these beautiful, beautifully painted feasting vessels as part of this expression of largesse. Of
conspicuous consumption. I can afford to break. Right. It's like the you throw your beautiful wine glass at the. Mm-hmm.
They were doing this at Altunha and I think elsewhere. Now that archaeologists are paying much more attention to these middens, so what we had thought was very solid evidence for the location of the workshops turns out to be completely wrong. So identifying where the workshops are found, we're not doing it by excavating them. We're doing it by looking for these patterns based on, in this case, the combination of material science analysis and stuff like what Bob is doing and the art historical analysis of painting style and looking for the hands of the artists. So it's much more inferential, and it's getting at that core question, which I agree with you, that's a really important one, but we're coming to it from the outside.
Thank you.
For cloth, you have spindle whorls. There's a beautiful one in the show made out of greenstone. It just looks like a little marble or something, or a big bead, but it's what you stick on the wooden spindle and you spin it and you make your thread. So people do a lot with finding, if they find a really big concentration of these little tools for making thread, they begin to think a bunch of people are sitting around spinning thread here. But you can also take your spindle whorl with you and walk down the road and spin thread. So again, like Dorie says, there's a lot of inference in it. Now in South America, there are workshops that have been found. So that various cultures, we have found them. We have found where they were smelting for the Sican people in Peru. We are getting towards that, but what Dorie said was that you're not going to be doing it in the palace. So most archaeology has started with all the good stuff in the center, the fancy places, and it's only been in the last few generations that people have moved out to the, and how are you going to find that little place? It's not going to be as big as this room, usually, to make the pots. And you're going to have to be kind of lucky to find those outside areas where the things are being made. But it's a great moment when you do.
And the only place for the Maya where we have found these workshops of high status goods are, in fact, it is textile production. Takeshi Inomata at the University of Arizona did very careful excavations in the palaces at Aguateca in south central Guatemala, and in fact found enough of these spinner whorls, the dye jars that were used for dyeing the cloth, and a few other tools, the remains or the impressions of the tools in the palace. The palace had been burned and the roof collapsed and really helped preserve a lot of this stuff, but the distributional pattern of the things that he found there strongly indicate that the royal ladies were in fact weavers.
But that's part of your status. That's what Dorie was talking about. Your high status is not only what you wear, but probably what you can make. You make, if you can make your own fantastic, right, your status will be higher. To us, we have people who manufacture stuff and we don't consider them very high. But I think it's the opposite in the ancient world. A woman, of course, would have to be able to weave beautifully, weave for her future husband, weave for everyone in the family, and then her status would be very high.
That pattern definitely exists today among Maya weavers in southern Guatemala, that a woman's status, a young girl's status as a potential bride and then as a mature woman, is higher in the community if she is renowned for her weaving skills. So again, inferentially, we suggest that this pattern held true back into classic times.
And also, weaving is a metaphor for creation of the universe, for the connection between that beautiful black pot that had the gods and the bundles. Right. It's all connected up with ropes that are sort of coming down from the celestial, and that's how the world is conceived of as being created. And the famous book, The Popol Vuh, one of the translations of the very beginning of it, Maya book, is that the world was stretched like the loom. The gods stretched the threads on the four posts to start weaving the world. So it's very different from the word in Judeo-Christian. It would be a word is spoken and that's how it starts. This is the world is woven. So that a woman being a good weaver is not just, you know, hey, look how pretty I am. It is a cosmological statement, too, that she can bring together the different parts of the cosmos and so on.
And on that pot, the hieroglyphic text that talks about the scene, which is the birth of the universe, the entire scene, as Rebecca said, is connected by these woven threads. But the verb that's used is actually birth. It's the same verb, the same inflection on the word for to birth that is used for a woman giving birth to a child.
It's one of those good linguistic, you need to know linguistics and right, hieroglyphics.
So that's a good way to tie up this discussion. I want to thank our speakers one more time for coming. And I want to thank our audience for coming out on this nasty rainy day and hope you enjoy what you've heard and enjoy the exhibit. Thank you very much.